Kieran Lagabiru, Adam.
Kieran Lagabiru to you, Paul. This week, summer blockbuster season continues with Jurassic World Dominion.
Yes, and you can tell it's big because everyone is back. We're talking about Chris Pratt.
Everyone. Bryce Dallas Howard.
Flattering pick.
Okay.
Sam Neill.
Sam Neill's back.
Yep.
Laura Dern. She's back.
Yep. Jeff Goldblum. There he is.
Goldblum. Wong.
Yep. Dinosaurs.
Other dinosaurs.
Yeah, with this, the Megasteca Triceratodecahedrosaurus, I think.
Sweet. That means the kitchen is back?
I don't know. There it is. The kitchen is back.
There's the kitchen. It's back. Oh, my God. Hey, wait. The reflection in the kitchen is back?
There it is.
Oh, my God. Hey, wait. Is Richard Attenborough back?
Pretty sure he died in 2014, Adam.
Oh. We didn't know that. He didn't get in. Well, we didn't know that he didn't get encased in amber, so.
That is nonsense. But hey, good for you with this, because this is Monday Movie Nonsense.
Monday Movie! I guess that wasn't the Sam Raimi opening, but anyway, this still works.
Can you go wrong with the Top Gun clip? No.
You can't beat it. Well, welcome to Movie Nonsense, folks. This is happening every Monday at 6 Eastern, 3 Pacific. No matter what's happening, no matter what personal tragedies are happening, if you've seen our videos, attended our live shows, or gone to the massive archive at of the movie guys and typed in Steve Lewis and looked up videos of Steve Lewis. If you've done that, or if you've seen us in the Movie Trivia Schmodown, then you know we're all about the nonsense, as was Steve Lewis. And they don't stop making movies. So we don't stop making comedy shows about movies, which means you can get a new show every week absolutely free. And we encourage you to subscribe. And you know what? If you do that, no charge.
No charge, Paul.
Paul, this is one of the few free things going right now, right? I mean, you're getting charged out the butt for CNN. They're trying to charge for CNN. People are like, what?
Well, here, stop that.
No charge. No charge for that now. Once again, back to your basic cable fee for that one. But anyway, but hey, we'd love to be in front of more people. We do this show every week. Paul and I bring everything we can to it. Blood, sweat, tears.
And just so you know, I need to work this into the opening every week.
Yeah.
The show is, we're not delivering it to you because it's done. We're delivering it to you because it's three.
Because it's three. There you go. But I'll tell you what. Paul and I can, by the seat of our pants, put on a better show than most people who spend all week on it. I'll tell you. In 2 hours, we can somehow bring something good to the table here. So, like, subscribe, hit the alarm bell. Let us annoy you. Bringing up that text, go, oh my God, I'm subscribed to so many of these things here. Movie guys. Well, that one I'll go watch. So, hey. Say you haven't caught everything I said there. I'll tell you what. Just go find us out on the internet. Go to at the Movie Guys on Twitter, themovieguys.net. You can find all of our podcasts, a massive archive, including plenty of things that Stephen Lewis has been a part of. Our appearances on other radio, podcast shows, reviews, articles. Just search for us on Dogpile, Alta Vista, Ask Jeeves, or
Bing!
And we come right up.
Not sure Bing is a thing anymore, Adam, but search there anyway. You never know what you'll find. I haven't gone there to see if there's even a page that was once.
Does Bing even exist? I was just hearing someone going back and watching all the Spider-Man movies, and everything on that is like a Sony laptop and Bing. Like, everything has to be Bingable, I believe, in the first Spider-Man movie because it was a Sony production, right?
So, Adam mentioned one of our founding movie guys who was in videos all the way back to 2009 with us, live events, writing, reviews, and more. Stephen Lewis passed away last week, so we wanted to honor him with a clip show today. But of course, we're the movie guys. We have to talk about what's new, so we'll devote some brief time to that. There he is.
There he is, the Incredible Hulk, Steve Lewis. And one of my favorite sketches we ever did. I don't know if you brought a clip of that, but we'll talk about the roast, because the premise with which he was the punchline is one of my favorites. So
yes, you know what? Video of that, I did have it. It's not watchable, really.
Yeah, his way, the camera's way in the back.
Roast at something called Whedon Con before Whedon there was Con. No more Joss Whedon.
Yeah,
and that was really good. I was super proud of that. We did it twice. So
And that, so
some more, because a lot of people here probably found us through the Movie Trivia Schmodown,
right,
where Adam and I play in movie trivia matches for tens of thousands of people worldwide, and it's quite a fan base. And they might just see me and Adam and go, "They're the movie guys." Well, of course, many of you got to meet or see Karen Volpe, my late wife, who was also with the movie guys from the very beginning. Yep. She passed away recently, and now, well, 3 years ago now, 2.5.
Sure.
And Stephen Lewis now is another movie guy to have passed on us, and it's no good, but it's a terrible reason to look at old Steve clips. But for those of you who don't know who he is, you should. So he's a prominent voice in the movie guys archives everywhere, and so we definitely want to honor him today with a clip show and a bunch of other stuff. So there's plenty of people out there in the world who you don't know how funny they are or don't know who they are, and we can change that for Steve for today, and so we will.
And maybe we'll make a corner of the movie guys website too, and we'll just put a bunch of his, you know, best of and everything. My mom is here, and she knew Steve for I became friends with Steve in college, so that's like 1991 that I would have met him, and we've pretty much followed each other one way or another throughout life. So mom is very familiar with Stephen Lewis, basically a family member. So thank you, mom, for tuning in. But you act like it's off topic. However, you talk about Jurassic World, Paul. One of the funny things about Steve is you never knew what movie he would flip out and love, because he was a little curmudgeonly, you know, like Star Wars, like once it got past it, well, he didn't even like Jedi. It was, you know, things like that, like if it was, a popular thing, he's, that's not for me. And then every once in a while, you get a call from him, and you go, "Have you seen Jurassic World?" And he's like,
"Right.
I watched it twice in a row." And you're like, "Really?" Like, I would think that would be the first thing. You'd be like, "This CGI dinosaurs or whatever." But he focused on, like, the energy of the filmmaking, which is why I love Sam Raimi so much. Sort of the rapidness of the storytelling. And it's like, every once in a while, you'd be like, "Am I being dragged to the cable guy?" Like, before, like, I went to Chicago once, and he, like, cornered me. He's like, "Have you seen the cable guy?" And I had, but I was like, "It was good," whatever. And he's like, "Oh, we got to watch it. We got to watch it." And then, you know, before you know it, you're at the cable guy, and you get his whole point of view on it. You're like, "That actually is a masterpiece. Okay, I got to agree with you."
Well, much like Karen passed a year before Ghostbusters Afterlife.
Oh.
2 years.
Before,
because of all the stupid delays.
That's true.
Steve will miss Jurassic Park Dominion, the return there in the bottom of the main three from the first movie, Ian Malcolm, Alan Grant, and Ellie Sadler, joining all the new characters who
have names.
I can't believe
this. Who have names?
Who's learned that?
Chris. Well, I believe Chris Pratt's character's name's Chris Pratt's character, right?
Right.
And Bryce Dallas Howard definitely plays
Ron
Howard's daughter. Yeah. Will there be flares, Paul?
Good Lord. Yes, quite. That's all I see in the ads and the trailers.
Well, go ahead. Well, no, I was going to say, this is also the anniversary of you and I deciding to see every summer movie together. So we met 24 years ago. I like you saying 25. It's more round that way. But I think it's 24. And the very first movie you and I saw together, if anybody doesn't know, I met Paul because he made an obscure Harrison Ford reference in a play he was doing, or a sketch show he was doing. And I went up afterwards and I went, "I got that joke." So we realized we both liked movies, and we decided to go see every summer movie. And the very first one was The Lost World Jurassic Park.
Now... this is coming out. So Adam will have to see this in our 25 year anniversary of seeing every summer movie together.
We'll make up our own story here.
Just 1 year younger. I know you want to be 1 year younger.
Of course.
So we'll watch this this weekend and check it out. I feel like this movie snuck up on us. I've heard about it a bunch. And maybe it's too much Top Gun Maverick in my head, which I have no problem with. Saw that a second time. But it's like, oh, this is upon us. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Then.
Well, so. And you know, and I've said this before for Blade Runner 2049, is the great triumph of me not paying attention to every single rumor, every single thing about every single thing that's coming up, because I was genuinely surprised in the theater that Harrison Ford was in the movie. and I should have known that. This, when I saw the trailer, I was like, get out of here! They're all back? Like, and I think everybody else knew for months and months and months that the original cast was going to be back, but I saw the trailer and I was like, what?!
Oh, good. I didn't spoil it for you here.
So no. But I didn't know till the trailer. And that was just like, that's so exciting. Like, I used to love the days of the rumor mill. You're following, you know, such and such, especially for The Phantom Menace. I got obsessed with it because you absolutely could not convince me they were making another Star Wars movie until it was literally in theaters at that time. So actually hearing reports of it, because I'd spent plenty of time. Oh, yeah, sure, they're going to make a new Star Wars. Give me a break. Don't quit reporting it, you know. And so then I followed that intensely, and it kind of ruined the movie for me. So I was like, all right, enough, you know, following every single rumor that's going on about movies, you know. The In It Cool News days. So this was a genuine surprise.
I feel like very exciting. Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull was the last time it was sort of work to follow a movie. Because I remember I did that hardcore. That film, I was so excited for it to come out. I feel like after that, like every movie, I know so much about it by the time it comes out, is a little mystery lost. Absolutely.
Claire
Deering. Yes, I've
anyone know what movie that's from? Claire.
Breakfast Club.
Yeah, Breakfast Club.
Answer
the question, Claire.
So I will see this. I'm not as thrilled for Colin Trevorrow to return. I don't know why. I just don't think he does much for me. But you and I saw Fallen Kingdom together. I thought that was great. A lot of crap.
It does, yeah.
But setting us up for this, like, that movie did things in every corner that I was like, I didn't expect that.
No.
And then for as wild and crazy as it got, he stuck the landing, I think was the term we always use with that movie, and set us up for this craziness where now, like, you know, he kind of went, well, dinosaurs are in the suburbs. Have a nice third movie. And now it's that. And it looks like they're going to have to play with and address that. I look forward to it.
Yeah. Oh, it's so cool. Epic conclusion. So this is the second trilogy. Yes. I wasn't going to say that. I wasn't going to shame Mom, but that is a... oh my gosh, look at this. What is this? Fallen Kingdom has a gun that shoots dinosaurs at people.
That's on you.
Good call. That's on you.
But so we'll go watch this and raise a glass to Steve as we do it.
Yeah, absolutely. God, he was obsessed with Jurassic World. I think he saw it 4 times in the theater. And then maybe didn't see another movie that entire year. That's like the way he was, you know, but
What was his favorite movie of all time? Do you remember?
His favorite movie of all time? Of all time.
Well, let's just say, all right, let me take a different.
The Graduate, maybe?
Yeah, see, right. So he likes this? Right, I get where you're coming from, where you go, what?
Yeah. Yeah. So. I mean, maybe Caddyshack or something? Or, yeah, gosh, what was, of all time, that's actually.
Darkman?
Yeah. I'm not sure. Oh, yeah, it might be Darkman or, yeah, but it see, might be Darkman. He loved Darkman.
That's a thing that Adam, we knew that Steve, you know, was not long for this world when he wasn't getting out of the house to see Sam Raimi direct a Marvel movie. So we knew.
Everybody will appreciate this that is watching right now, because this is our movie fans here, and they're on the level, and you know that's why we have a bunch of people who thankfully, and thank you all, watch the show every week. I mean, these names, some of the names come up here I've seen since day one on the show, so God bless you all. But you will get this when, you know, he was an enormous Sam Raimi fan, loved every Sam Raimi movie, finally, and loved Spider-Man. Finally, Raimi, after, I don't know, what, 10 years of retirement, basically, was coming back to not only directing, But directing a Marvel movie, a comic book movie, a comic book that once you've seen the movie, you would argue he probably likes better than Spider-Man. And Steve was suffering from depression. And when I said, let's go see Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. And he was lukewarm on it. And I frankly could have called the police right there. So I think everyone here understands, like, if you've got a friend that is not excited about a certain movie and you know them through that filmmaker, you're like, well, that's a bad sign. So, yeah, no, he didn't want to go see Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness, and he was on kind of a bummer, and that's too bad. In my head canon, before he passed, he did go see it, just not with me.
Well, he'll miss this too. I don't know if he cares as much though, but I also need to know what this is about. So I'm referring to my Marvel specialist, Adam Witt. What is Ms. Marvel? Okay. This is TV, I know, but listen, it's an extension of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, perhaps the greatest cinematic achievement in the history of the movies. So absolutely, we need to talk about Ms. Marvel. So who is she? What is this? Adam, what's going on?
Paul, you tasked me with looking up some information. No, you tasked me with knowing some information on Ms. Marvel because I know comic books. I do have to say, Ms. Marvel slipped into the cracks of my comic book reading. Now, I know there is, I know her name's Kamala Khan. I know her power is she stretches, is the thing I remember from the comic books. And that her power somewhat derives from sort of the Marvel line, Captain Marvel, Marvel, that there is something cosmic that is connected to those people that imbues her with powers. I do not know that much about Kamala Khan. So I actually, Paul, all I know is from watching the preview that what a cool style that Marvel's brought to this new one, right? I mean, this is practically like Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse type, you know, excitement and animation and, you know, the animated fonts and stuff like that. Okay, here we go. See, this is what I'm depending upon here. She was an Inhuman. Paul, do you know who the Inhumans are? I can help you with that.
It was a TV show I didn't watch.
Okay. The Inhumans were people that lived on the moon who got their powers from the Tarragon mists. See? Act like I don't know nothing about superheroes.
Tarragon, the spice?
Yeah, yes, exactly. They were the masters of the spice tarragon, and that's how they got their powers. You love a good amount of tarragon. Well, these people loved tarragon on their foods. Okay, so she is not I didn't see her stretch once in the trailer. So it looked like she has all kinds of other cosmic powers, and it looks like they might be connecting her more to Captain Marvel. I think she was just given the name Ms. Marvel as a cool Marvel name. Coy, get in here. Coy, where's Coy? Coy, what's it about? But that premieres this week, huh?
Yeah, I got a buddy who works on the when you walk up to a premiere and you see all the production design there, including the red carpet. He works on a lot of that, so I knew they were having their premiere, and I believe it was at El Capitan, like Disney tends to do. So probably would have learned a lot watching that. Well, then you know what? I'm excited because I know nothing.
Yeah,
nothing. I go in, learn a bunch. I'm down with that.
Paul, I'm sorry. So did I say
it happened with Moon Knight?
Paul, did I say you didn't know anything about it? I absolutely know all kinds of stuff about it. Paul, she's a Pakistani-American growing up in Jersey City. Kamala Khan idolizes superheroes like Captain Marvel. No, I mean, I know this. I know. I'm not reading. Yeah, just off the top of my head. Never dreaming she'd have an opportunity to join her role models in safeguarding society from the forces of evil with an inhuman ability to alter her shape and size. The newest Miss Marvel employs an idealistic attitude as much as any power to make the world a better place.
That's great, Adam. Thanks. All right, that opens on Wednesday. So actually, day after tomorrow. And then you'll have, so Wednesday delivers Obi-Wan Kenobi and Ms. Marvel episodes for the next 3 weeks or so at least. And then Ms. Marvel will go on past that until She-Hulk kicks in. And we got Thor, July 7th. Marvel, it's the best.
Yeah, so I mean, but the point, the great thing about this is now I get to go into a Marvel series, much like other people went into Moon Knight, like 100% like, you know, whatever story you got to tell me, Marvel, I'm in. You know, I mean, Marvel has now caught up to my knowledge of superheroes in the last few years. Like, even Shang-Chi is largely the more modern Shang-Chi. I knew these sort of like 70s, like, hey, let's take advantage of all the hot trends, you know, blaxploitation movies and Power Man, you know, karate with Iron Fist and Shang-Chi and that sort of stuff. So, you know, that's, they've now expanded kind of beyond what I knew. Even like Hawkeye, you know, I knew a little bit about I knew the old Hawkeye, but I didn't know as much about the new younger Hawkeye. So this I'm pretty excited about, because I just get to watch Marvel's storytelling on display and not go, oh, okay, so they're doing that instead of that or whatever. Although I do see here that she was, as someone said here, Black Bolt, you now know from Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness.
He was
right?
Inhumans, right?
I love Black Bolt, a great character. I love how they just used him for a brief moment in that. Says he released the Terrigen mists into Earth's atmosphere, transforming several latent members of the superpowered race. So there might be an actual Inhuman connection in this. Although somebody here said that they might be going somewhere different.
Well, so. The next Captain Marvel movie is called The Marvels, so perhaps will be a coming together of all, you know, that includes who was the character from
Captain Marvel from when I was a kid.
His name I forget.
Yeah, her character. Oh, it's Monica Rambeau.
Correct. And then you get Brie Larson, and then you bring in Amin Vellani, who's playing this character. Basically, the thing, we need to get on to Steve, but the thing that is important to know is early reports are saying, you talk about that visual style, it looks like this is going to be kind of like a Scott Pilgrim versus the World Marvel movie. Yes. So I'm excited for that.
Yeah, very exciting.
Some quick notes, news and notes type stuff. Top Gun Maverick is still a beast at the box office with only 32% drop week. So that's $549 million global in 2 weeks, the biggest movie ever, 2 weekends, not even full 2 calendar weeks. The biggest movie ever for Tom Cruise is a worldwide gross of $700 million and something with Mission Impossible Fallout. And according to the third-party researcher called Samba TV, the 1986 Top Gun has been watched in 2 million U.S. households between May 25th and June 1st. Unheard of for old films, on par with Zack Snyder's Justice League, but more importantly, like, more people I think watched that than Stranger Things.
Wow.
To get ready for Top Gun Maverick. So this is a general phenomenon. So.
Yeah.
And the aforementioned Doctor Strange crossed 900 million as well, so worldwide. So that's fantastic.
And as I've said, post-pandemic, and Cam says this very correctly about our friend Stephen Lewis, that really is what was the worst thing for his depression, was, you know, just this, the dread, and, you know, pretty existential dread too, you know, with Trump in the White House and stuff. You know, I guess he has his fans, but it's understandable feeling that everything was going to hell. and it was a but what's so cool is it's like everything's back at the theater. It just feels good to go laugh with your friends for Jackass. It feels like a family reunion with Spider-Man. And now it's like, oh, remember how good you felt at the time in 1986 when you watched Top Gun? You know, and that was a lot of like rah-rah America. And without bombing a single Russian, this one's very rah-rah America too. Like, come on, let's all get back into it. Let's feel good. It's a feel-good movie that happens to be a legacy sequel. You know, it's really cool.
I sure hope, Jurassic World Dominion continues that sort of summer
another
movie
reunion
because it's just fun.
Yeah, so it's like feel good time at the movies.
My last weekend was spent at a Tears for Fears concert. I think they're one of the most underrated bands of all time. I know they have had one of the biggest songs ever, but if you go deep on their albums, they are brilliant.
Yeah,
and they don't have a lot, so also they have like 6 albums, maybe 7, mm-hmm. something like that, over 40 years. And they got back together and put out a new album called The Tipping Point, which is excellent. It's poetic and sad and brilliant. And they toured, and it was sold out at the Forum, which is great. I love to see that. Garbage opened for them, the Shirley Manson-led rock band Garbage.
Wow.
A little about.
Right, I'd recognize two of their songs.
I know Stupid Girl, I'm Only Happy When It Rains. Like, and then, but otherwise, they're kind of a good industrial band. It was a nice opener for Tears for Fears. And then they played a song. They said, we don't really play this one much, but we're in Hollywood, so we wanted to play this song for you guys. And they said, no, you're playing this because I'm here. And they reminded me that they recorded a Bond theme. I forgot. And so I got treated to a little bit of The World Is Not Enough.
Yes.
About that, first of all, I wonder if we'll get a copyright strike for a crap recording in a loud, echoey forum.
No,
you never know, been hit for weirder things. And I guess I didn't have a second thing. How cool is that?
That song's a banger.
Oh,
is that your second thing?
They all are, right? Like, have that moment where you're just like, is this a Bond theme? If you didn't know the song, you'd be like, it's just so moody and dips into the word I'm looking for. It's all throughout Danny Elfman's score into minor chords. You go, this is a Bond theme, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, and it's got that Shirley Bassey thing too, that world. You can absolutely hear like Shirley Bassey. Get the hell out of here. Garbage is from Dayton. Did I know that? Oh man.
Yeah. So there's a whole lot of Shirley. Here's another Shirley Manson fact. Okay, now Shirley is Scottish, so I don't know if they're from Dayton. Actually, the keyboardist was from Englewood, where the forum is, so I know they announced that.
Englewood's in Ohio? Oh, sorry.
Oh, no, sorry. Tears for Fears keyboardist is from Dayton, because they're a duo, basically, put whoever around them.
Oh, okay. So maybe part of the band is from, or maybe the band was formed in
There's
Dayton.
A real celebrity encounter there. Shirley Manson stepped on my foot. All right, so that's that, but that's cool. Other quick news I want to get to real quick. It's not all Stephen Lewis in the celebrity deaths this week. Bo Hopkins died. You remember
Bo Hopkins,
American Graffiti,
and the whatever of Lieutenant Callie with Harrison Ford. What's that called? The something of Lieutenant Callie.
Oh, he was in that TV show? We haven't covered the TV movies on the Ford Fiesta yet.
No.
But if you want to hear about Bo Hopkins and Harrison Ford's crazy offset adventures while they were shooting American Graffiti, check out the Ford Fiesta featuring the movie guys.
And Stephen
Lewis. Everywhere where you can get, literally everywhere where you can get podcasts. Amazon, Pandora, Spotify, iTunes, Apple Music, right on down the line. All the apps.
Judgment. Judgment, the court martial of Lieutenant William Callie, he was the prosecuting. The one clip I've seen from that is Harrison Ford on the stand, and I believe Bo Hopkins was the prosecutor. Like, he's grilling Harrison Ford. So it's kind of cool because they were friends. In fact, they were, they destroyed the hotel rooms during American Graffiti. Like, they were both threatened to be kicked off the movie together. So that's how close they were. And then, they were in the court martial of Lieutenant William Callie.
Well, here's someone who can't wait for the next phase of the Ford Fiesta. How far away are we from season two, Adam, of the Apocalypse Now? I know you had a busy weekend.
But... Any date? Well, yeah, it's been a rough week. No, that is my next thing I have to do. We prepared this show today and put a lot of clips together. I finished a lot of old pieces with Steve and, so each time I sit down to my computer, I have some mission and, now I can do this, Paul. Now we can just, do this. So there it is. There's my to-do.
Very nice.
It'll be up this week.
It's, funny Adam's thing. I think we said it before on here, but when you don't put up a show for a couple of months, you finally go, Oh, coming soon, season two.
Season two. And of course, we naturally would divide Harrison Ford's career into pre-apocalypse now and post-apocalypse now.
As the public does.
Yeah. As the public does. That's why season two begins with apocalypse now. Of course, it's totally intentional.
Yeah, but this one's going to be a good one to come back with John Kaiser joining us. And then correct. I think we got to get on our... get on your boots. Is that the U2 song? We got to get on our boots because we still want the last episode to come out right before Indiana Jones and the fifth movie, whatever it's going to be called.
Yeah, Indiana Jones and the Adventures of the Fifth Movie.
Yes. All right, but let's talk about Steve. Okay, so folks who might be just arriving into the show, we announced that we lost our good friend Stephen Lewis in the last couple of weeks, and he was a great contributor to the Movie Guys for years. And we want to honor him because you don't know how, there are plenty of you out there who may not know how funny Steve is.
Yes.
And we're going to change that today.
And also, I have to say, one of Steve's, we had a line that never made it in the show, but Steve, I'll quote Steve here. He always wanted to, or we always joked about beginning a show, especially a live show at the Second City, because we did a bunch of live shows with Steve as well, is to say to an entire audience that took their Friday night or whenever we did that show Thursday night and came out to the Second City and found parking, all this stuff, he always wanted to begin his show with, "Now, I know you were all wondering, why are we bothering you?" we never begin the show with that line, but that was a Stephen Lewis line that, "Now, I know you're wondering, why are we bothering you?" So, yes. So the story of Steve, yeah, there we are in Vegas. We used to do a yearly, or at least twice in a row, did a yearly trip to Vegas, and it would just be an all-nighter. We'd catch a bus at night, we'd go, we'd place our bets for football, and we would just place our bets for the game, we'd go hit the diner, and then we'd just sit and watch football all day with, like, bets on the game and stuff. So, yeah, that was a little Vegas trip we took. I won some money. I think he lost or broke even.
Well, what's that here?
There's David Sachs. Yeah, so we decided in mid-quarantine, like, let's just get together and throw around some ideas and talk some skits. So we walked up, this might be a separate hike, actually, but we went up to the Hollywood Bowl parks there, and we just sat around for, like, 2 hours, just, you know, shooting around sketches, just being creative, just a pure break from the quarantine. That might have been a hike where they sent me photos as well, but, you know, hikes was a good way during quarantine to keep the juices flowing. But that's Dave Sachs from Tower Players and many other Movie Guys shows.
Yeah, I mean, he appeared back in the Toad Hop days when our show was right. On the same night as the Schmoes Know.
And coming up on the Blade Runner Ford Fiesta.
Yeah, correct. He was our guest.
We recorded that. Back when we were on such a schedule, he's like, "Hey, guys, I got to go out of town for a week. Should we just record that now?" And that's now 3 months ago. But I met Steve in my improv with my improv group, which Dave Sachs was a part of. And anybody who's been in improv knows that when you meet that magical group of people that are, like, on the level for quoting Monty Python and all that sort of stuff. But just like with Paul Preston, I realized I had a bigger affinity for movies that I connected with Steve for. So we spent some time in college, and then we later roomed in Chicago. If you'd like to explain the premise of the of this show where he played the Hulk, since we've shown it twice.
Okay, at this thing called Weedonopolis, we did the superhero roast because Joss had directed Justice League, and what it was characters from Marvel and characters from DC trying to get along.
Right.
And so they came together at this peace summit. But what it essentially was a roast where all the different characters roasted one another. We have Tony Stark on the far left, Steve next to him as Bruce Banner. Before this.
Right.
Later he hulked out.
I'm glad someone got that action photo.
Ken Bernard there as Batman. Right. Joe Canale, our guest last week, is Swamp Thing with a coffee, I guess.
Swamp Thing. As politically incorrect Swamp Thing. We probably couldn't show some of these clips because...
He really was. No, Sexist, Racist, Swamp Thing specifically was the name of his character.
Right.
And he always said something, and then we had to cut him off and get out.
Right, exactly. We'd have to cut him off. And he would always say it like Swamp Thing. Swamp Thing. He would say it like Swamp Grimlock,
thing,
basically.
Jews, blah, blah, blah. Like, stop, okay,
stop. And then Captain America.
I was Captain America, and Karen was Black Widow.
Black Widow.
Pretty much using her Bouvet sister's
wig. And, yeah, and the wig
all
is.
These pics looked great. Yeah, Swamp Thing.
And look at that Superman, Swamp Thing.
Not pictured there, but you were.
I was taking the photo, I think.
That Swamp Thing.
That's Karen's Bill Murray helmet, yeah. Right? From when, and then it's I found
just,
a.
It's little... just some.
What a great low-rent Swamp Thing with Joe Canelli.
Superman, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Dr. Horrible, turns out, was behind everything.
Right, because it was the Whedon Con, so we had a special appearance by Dr. Horrible at the end. They had put the whole thing together to destroy the superheroes.
Right.
Which is fun.
Me as Captain America.
Great big first joke of the show was, Paul, when you walked in with the Captain America shirt, you turned around, you had this, because you had a Frisbee that looked like the shield, and you go, I'll just put that on my back.
Yeah,
and
that's what I'm holding there.
It's yeah, when you take your military coat off and you turn around, you got this teeny tiny, that was the first big laugh of that show, this teeny tiny shield on your back.
Karen was Black Widow.
Black Widow.
Ken is Batman. <my dash.
laughs> We got to get Ken back on this show. I love
That'd
Ken.
That'd be fun. He's awesome. So,
but the great joke was.
Eight. Yeah.
Collect all eight. Yeah.
Trading card
I love we had our trading cards. But the great joke was, of course, you go around the dais. We wrote all these jokes.
Oh, sorry.
You know,
Tony Stark, too. I don't want
to. And Tony Stark.
Tony Stark.
Tony Stark makes you feel he's a cool exec with a heart of steel. But the great joke was, because you'd go around the dais and, you know, each person that got up would say a joke about this guy, a joke about that guy. You know, that good-natured ribbing was the thing. But every time you got to Dr. Banner, every time you got to Dr. Banner pre-Hulk out, they would make fun of him, and he would stand up and get mad. You're like, oh, that's right. We can't make fun of him the way we can everybody else. So that happened several times, and then finally, like, somebody got up and was like, yeah, I don't want to say this about Dr. Banner, but blah, blah, blah. And finally, it's like, that's it! And just blew up. It was such a good joke that, like, every time you made fun of Dr. Banner, it'd be like, oh, whoa, 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 whoa.
Great call there, Randy. We did not. No.
We couldn't CGI that out.
So that was awesome. I loved that
whole event.
Yeah, we did it twice. I took it to the All-Star Comic Con in Washington. Not quite the same result with the local actors. It was better with our gang here. You know?
Oh, yeah. Well, we had... The crew we had when we're putting something that together is like, wow, what a bunch of pros, you know?
Yeah, we had Ron Babcock join us the next year.
It's Professor X.
Dr. Xavier, yeah.
Right.
So that was fun.
And me as sweaty, terrible, super low-rent Wolverine. I looked so bad. I couldn't get my hair to stand up, so it just, like, drooped and fell. So I just looked like this, and then at the end of it, I have this, like, terrible, like, the A-shirt, and I'm just like, I just look so... I am Batman with a mustache.
All right, so eventually we started, one of the first things we did after I created the movieguys.net was to start making comedy videos in my garage.
Yeah.
This is what it was.
There it is.
I put up a bunch of posters. We put some chairs up, and there's Steve next to me with Adam holding the boom mic, a light and a camera on us, and all around us, garage.
So much garage.
Boxes
oh,
and stuff,
my gosh.
An old Zenith television. Above the television, kind of to the left, is... dogs playing pool. I still have that. Some classic posters. The toy. I had
the
that
toy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Edward Scissorhands and that Lemony Snicket.
So what do you think we were talking about? Because I'm seeing Edward Scissorhands, Nightmare Before Christmas, the toy, and Jim Carrey. What do you think the movies were that week? Just based on, because you always designed it. You know, you always designed the posters based on what was coming out that week. But I couldn't tell you something. Tim Burton, I would say, I guess.
Let me take a guess at that.
The toy.
There's a new movie coming out that stars Jason Lee, David Cross, Amy Poehler, and Christina Applegate. Do you want to see it? Congratulations! You just bought a ticket to Alvin and the Chipmunks: The Squeakquel.
I'm sure there are many out there who are looking to slam this movie for what they perceive as crass commercialism. But what's the point? I mean, is it desecrating some kind of sacred icon? Was there a time when Alvin and the Chipmunks had street cred? Have they gone to Vegas? Is that the beef? It's the Chipmunks, for God's sake. I mean, what's being sullied here? Their Christmas song? Come on. If you like the Chipmunks, go see the fucking movie. Why wouldn't you? While the title sounds like it could be a new movie rating, It's Complicated is actually the latest comedy from writer-director Nancy Myers, which means it will probably be anything but.
Anything but a comedy or anything but complicated?
Pick one.
The auteur of such froth fests as What Women Want, Something's Gotta Give, and The Holiday, Myers excels at casting A-list actors like Jack Nicholson, Diane Keaton, and Mel Gibson, and sucking whatever life and interest they have out of them. Here, she casts Steve Martin, Meryl Streep, and Alec Baldwin, three of the most talented and entertaining performers on the planet. She's got her work cut out for her, but I wouldn't bet against her.
Interestingly, this is the first movie ever to co-star Steve Martin and Meryl Streep, a fact which may prompt you to scratch your head and wonder what has taken Hollywood so long. This is a pairing that seemed inevitable as far back as 1979, when Streep first amazed the world with her Oscar-winning performance acting opposite Dustin Hoffman in Kramer vs. Kramer, while Martin delighted audiences playing opposite a dog named Shithead in The Jerk. The fact that these two have finally gotten together on screen gives renewed hope to that long-dormant Cheech and Chong Vanessa Redgrave project we've all secretly hoped for, so let's keep our fingers crossed on that one.
Let's just stop there.
Oh my gosh.
That's
jokes,
exactly
man.
What was being shot right there.
Oh, wow. Right. Okay, so that's exactly that. Wow. That's a good show. Cheech and Chong, Vanessa Redgrave. Holy crap. That's funny.
Yeah. So what else we have in here? There's another photo we didn't look at. I don't know what that is. You must have uploaded it there, Adam, underneath the Ghostbuster party pics. Seventh or eighth photo down. Can't tell. Let me just bring it up.
That's our old apartment. I was going to say we lived.
I remember that. Oakwood,
yeah, remember
right?
that place? Yeah, Oakwood. And there were a couple other photos, because he sent me this about about 6 months ago. He was just whenever he was in the neighborhood, he would take photos of the old hood. This is the apartment we lived in. The other two photos, which I probably should have brought up here, because we had the craziest mural of a guy singing in front of this giant group of people. This is right next to the laundromat, and he looked like Donny Osmond. It was already faded when we lived there. This is now 15 years ago. And it's the Donny Osmond's still there and just getting more bleached and more bleached and more bleached. And it was across the street from, and people will know this because I've seen people post this on Twitter as well, right around Beverly and Western is the futuristic KFC with the giant head of the Colonel on top of this futuristic cube. So it's like, I don't know what the building was built for, not a KFC. However, at some point it was turned into a KFC instead of a modern art exhibit. And they used all of the architecture to sort of put KFC stuff on. And at the top was this giant cube, which now rests far, far above that area of Koreatown, the head of the Colonel. But that was we lived there for 7 years. It was a good time. So yeah, that's why I had that up there. I meant to pop that up when I said we lived with each other many times. And look at the protection on the balcony to the right. Look at the shards of metal sticking out there. Where do you rarely see that? Don't climb up that sucker.
I wanted to pull something myself here and see if I can show it real quick. Apropos of nothing, but I know that the thing I always noticed when I went to your apartment was it was right around the corner from that
ethical drugs
that KFC, and so I always noticed that when you look at the Colonel, and this is something I just want to point out to people in case you ever see him again, big head, little tiny body. Oh yeah. He just looks like he's a little tiny body with a big head. Hello, I'm the Colonel.
Hello,
I'm the Colonel. Anyway, that's again.
Yeah. So if you're ever along that strip, yeah. Well, that was apropos of the postmodern KFC on Western and Beverly, where Steve and I lived for many, many years.
And I should play something here next that really gives you an idea of what Steve's humor was like.
Mm-hmm.
Removed from movie guys. This is just a video he made. We did a little something called the Brain Trust. We were just cutting little comedy videos outside of Movie Guys, just for fun. This might have been before Movie Guys, because Movie Guys gave us the we could do this every week.
Yeah,
this is like, let's do this whenever we get a second. And this is what Steve came up with, something called, well, just watch it.
Every person ultimately needs a goal, a purpose, something tangible to accomplish. That way, you have a clearly defined activity to avoid doing. Simply sitting around and wasting time, that starts to feel aimless after a while. Stressful, too. As if your life is simply passing you by and you're not getting anything accomplished. But if you have something you're supposed to be doing and you're not doing it, well, then at least you're procrastinating.
That is so Steve. Wow. Yeah, right?
That's God. what we called on the old audio podcast.
Stephen Lewis joke.
Oh my God. You're bringing back memories I didn't know I had. Stephen Lewis joke. Yeah. That's great. What do we call that? Our little group
Brain
there?
Trust International.
Brain Trust International. Yeah, we're just looking for something. But yeah, like when we all were suddenly in town, all of us comedians, and we're like, we just got to do some stuff. So yeah, it was like you, me, Dave, Matt Lenhart. Yeah, we would just go shoot these shorts and stuff. And that one was because I was working with Steve. That's Nancy's old house. The first jobs I got, Steve, were with Nancy and her friend Eric, who chimed in on Facebook today wonderfully, because I posted this, a little RIP to Steve, because I got him, Steve, his first job, and we were driving up to the Hollywood Hills for one of them, and the other one was here at Nancy's house, because suddenly you're working out of people's, like, back rooms and stuff, because, like, the technology had advanced, so, you know, I came here and I didn't really go to a whole lot of offices. I started going to houses and working, and so that was Nancy's house, and I think that must have been some sort of thing during lunch, like Steve just presented me this little monologue that he created. I'm like, well, let's just shoot you running around procrastinating and I'll add it to the thing. I'd forgotten completely about that. Thank you for that. That's fun.
Yeah. Well, then we put together the 3-minute variety hour.
Yes.
Which I'll play some bits of. Here, just what?
Okay.
This is what we created.
Gonna walk 2, 3, 4 down the street, singing to the sidewalk as I keep to the beat of the cars. Of the cars.
Hey, oh, hey, Dad.
Son, how you doing?
Oh, what brings you out to the driveway?
Well, Mom said you might be out here. I thought I'd take this opportunity to tell you something.
What's on your mind?
Well, Dad, I think I might be gay.
So we begin another day in California.
Oh my God.
Bud Alabaster here, picking up where the good Lord left off. With the new Raymaster 2600, it's got 7 settings. We're currently in the shower mode. Shower gives a nice spray, not too thick. You don't want that flooding. Got a couple of gray patches, brown patches. Looks like we got a little area where the slip and slide left a few marks. Couple of weeds coming out there on the south side of the residence here in West Hills, California. Population 30,000, where it's a tepid 76 degrees. This weekend there's going to be a big old barbecue at Bud Alabaster's. First 50 folks get a free hat.
Nothing could be.
So the surgery was a big success.
It is. I can feel my legs again. Look, I can walk. This is going to be my year.
Walking in Los Angeles.
It was a beautiful day. You know, I mean, nobody thought that anything like this would happen, of course. No one could expect. You know, when you asked me what I remember, I remember laughter. I mean, we were all laughing. I remember a woman calling for her baby, and all I could feel was the blood running down my face, and wondering where my child might be. And
we need a release.
I guess to sum it up, the bus exploded? I don't. Because of the. Later they found the terrorists.
Could you initial down here too?
I'm gonna wave hello to the friends I meet The city seems much smaller when you travel by the side of the street.
So, what brings you out to the driveway?
Murder.
Hate crime?
You bet I do.
No, is this a hate...
I think I know who did this.
Yeah, fresh tire tracks. Tastes like a Michelin. 205-75-R14.
I got it!
Ooh. Just watch for the borders. Gonna sing a song to the meter maid. Tell her it's a holiday or maybe that there's a parade.
Thanks, Tanisha. Teddy Chang here with Channel 6 News. We're here with...
Lyle Lovett, no relation.
Well, how do you feel about the cul-de-sac killer?
We are on a through street and not a cul-de-sac, so I got my eyes all over the place. I know exactly where everybody is. I know what's coming. Hey, what channel is this going to be on?
Walking in Los Angeles. But who does it?
Oh my gosh.
Well, that's dumb, right?
That is dumb. That is such good dumb. Wow.
Yeah. Yes. The Bud Alabaster was, that's our friend Matt Lenhart. I think we were kicking around the idea of what does a sports guy do on the weekend?
Retired
kicking
sports guy.
Yeah. He retired, yeah. He announces his yard work.
Wow, that's really funny.
And then, what if you wanted to film some sketches, but you only had the camera that's in your vehicle when you go back?
Backup camera theater. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, it is dumb.
Hate crime. You bet I do. That was from our student sketch comedy show that I had with Bart and Matt Larson. That Matt Larson wrote that line, and he was also a close friend of Steve's and was on the call we had yesterday, too. But, hate crime. You bet I do. No. This is a hate crime.
That's all. Wow. Beside... movie guys, but there's more movie guys stuff to share. You want
lots of movie guys
show something
stuff,
or I got plenty.
Yeah, here, you know, why don't I show something more recent, because I had a couple things that one clip that he, you know, you'd get clips every once in a while from Steve and this is one I had prepped but not, you know, finished or exported for this show, I guess, at that point. But this is actually the should I do The Godfather? That's the very last thing we ever wrote and
yes,
made a
sequel. Save that
for the end. So
is
let me
get a good closer.
That's a good closer. Very good closer. Right. Just an incredibly clever idea that Steve had. We sat down one day and did it. So we'll bring that up.
A minute. You know what? I know you were doing some editing on that. I did some editing on Good Cop, which is from the same era of the Brain Trust.
Right.
3 Minute Variety Hour. So let me play that.
Oh,
real quick.
Run
then
that.
We can move on to the next.
Oh sure, yeah.
And I won't, this
well,
is,
let's just keep going in order then, and we'll we'll save the Sam Raimi sandwich, Untouchables, and Godfather for the end, because
these are not in like order in our list here on StreamYard. But yeah. So I got lost. But we
but you're right,
play
Good
this.
Cop, Good Cop, classic.
This is just the camera's rolling. You, Bart, and Steve just start going on. What if both cops interrogating were both good guys? And this was a long time ago. We didn't have mics, so it's a little rough. But
right, it's just the camera.
Enjoy the concept, which we really enjoy. And Steve's in the middle having to listen to these two idiots.
Sit down.
Or stand. It doesn't really matter.
Doesn't really matter. In fact, is that chair comfortable?
You know what? If you want to lie down, get some circulation to the legs.
We got some nice new Aeron chairs in the office. You can sit in one of those.
Lumbar support.
Yeah, because you know, if you sit in one of these hard chairs, you start to go numb from the waist below.
It's called economy class syndrome. You ever fly a coach, buddy? Huh?
No, really. If you want like a pillow or something, that'd be fine. That's like...
Seriously, if you just feel like stretching out or whatever. Hey, we're just talking.
Just friends here. We're just hanging out.
We're just talking. Just hanging out.
Thanks for stopping by.
Just us. Absolutely. You could tell us anything you want.
You know what? Maybe he should get him a pot of coffee. You want some coffee?
Oh, well, I believe I offered some coffee earlier, but somebody said no.
I was making a fresh pot, okay?
Oh, okay. Mr. Fresh Pot, would you like a fresh pot of coffee?
A fresh, hot pot of coffee?
How do you know he likes coffee? Maybe tea. Would you like some tea? Maybe some honey in that tea?
Mm-hmm. You want some milk? Maybe some sugar?
I have to tell you nothing.
It's true. He's got a point there.
He does.
You know what that's called? It's called the Bill of Rights, all right?
That's called the Miranda Rights.
Does somebody read you your Miranda Rights?
You don't have to answer anything. You can stay completely silent.
Because if they didn't, you can get the fuck up and walk right out.
Walk right out.
Just leave the door.
Don't tell us anything.
No, not
you can tell us we don't need to know shit.
That's right. All it's going to do is make my job harder. You know what you should do? You should get an attorney.
Oh, I'll get you an attorney.
No. I'll get you an attorney.
Don't listen to this guy. He'll get you a divorce attorney. That's the only attorney he knows. I know some real good criminal guys. Get you right out the door.
My attorney handles all sorts of law. Okay, divorce, accident, job claim, the other thing that everyone gets sued for all the time. He does that.
Don't listen to this guy. And I'll tell you why. Because this is a guy that's been in so many accidents and divorces that he knows this attorney. Look, I'm scot-free. I know a guy that's just going to help you out. He'll just get you to walk right out. In fact, right now you can tell me that you committed the murders last night, and he'd still be able to get you right out.
Shut up, both of you! Just shut up! I'll say anything you want to know! Sweet. Sucker.
Good cop.
Yeah, super rough. Just by
yeah, that was one of them that kind of got shot, never really put together. It was... Yeah, but still, it's such a great premise.
Absolutely.
Good cop. A nice, fresh, hot pot of coffee.
All right, that's enough of the early years. Some of them are way earlier. I don't even know if you have clips from college and stuff.
I have clips from college, but I didn't get to download them for this because Andy Eninger had a show called Stand Up in Studio C. Now this show is from 1990, I believe, and he had, I don't have a clip of it here, but he did The Last Temptation of Woody Allen, which was a parody at the time of The Last Temptation of Jesus Christ with Woody Allen as Jesus. Now that title would generate a different parody, but he did an amazing Woody Allen impersonation, and Woody Allen about to be crucified monologuing was a particular Steve special. I'll find that and put that up on the movie guys. We'll make a little special section on the website for him, at least a clip from that, because it was Stand Up in Studio C. You had to fill a half hour of sketch comedy once a week, and you know, so that's why they got a lot of stand up people to pad that out and stuff, so you know, sketches were allowed to go long because it's like we need content, so so I do have sketches from college, but I didn't bring any today, so we'll focus on the movie guys stuff that he did.
All right, I can play a quick thing. This features Steve and Karen Volpe.
Okay.
This is the Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows Part 2 had come out, and we spoiled the ending.
Okay.
The poster proclaims it all ends. And there's a lot of speculation as to how the franchise will wrap up, but we know how it ends.
That's right.
So, if you like surprises, you may want to avert your eyes now, or leave the room, perhaps.
Right. But for the rest of you who are here, here's what you've been waiting for 10 long years, the dramatic, climactic ending to the entire Harry Potter saga.
That's hilarious.
That's actually from, I should also note, you know, after the videos we did in the garage that you mm-hmm. saw, we did a live show. We did it at Improv Olympic for a couple of shows, and then for a year and three quarters at the Second City Hollywood, which is no more. It went the way of the pandemic. And we would just do a comedy movie sketch show. And it was, oh man, just to like do sketches about movies. We'd put an hour show together once a month, and it was just that's all it was. Here's another one that is all right. This I'd explained this yesterday. Well, actually, let me play a little bit of this first. I don't know where Steve is in this. I think he introduces it, but this is the Green Lantern press conference.
Oh, Steve loved the sketch though.
I'll tell you a trailer that is creepy though, Paul.
Yeah,
Green Lantern.
Oh, you didn't?
Yeah, I've seen this thing like three times, and I honestly, I can't make head or tail of it. I still don't know what this movie is about.
Yeah, Warner Brothers Pictures knows what you're talking about because you're not the only one.
No?
They set up a press conference to actually smooth over the confusion as to what the trailer's trying to convey.
Really?
Yeah, but let's do this anyway.
Okay.
Hello, everyone. Thank you all for coming. I'm Harry Balsack.
I'm the head of botched marketing campaigns at Warner Brothers, and I'm here to clarify the trailer for Green Lantern for all of you. First of all, I'd like to say that the film is a nonstop thrill ride, suitable for the whole family, and you'll love it because it's great. So, okay, any questions?
Hey, wait,
go ahead. Wait, right here.
What the fuck?
Okay. The fuck is, since the beginning of time, the universe has had a series of galactic guardians called Green Lanterns, and they operate out of a planet called Oa. So, any follow-up to that?
Seriously?
Each sector of the galaxy has a guardian, and their powers flow from the possession of a magical ring. So, there's that. Any other questions?
Wait, what?
You got me there. What I failed to mention was that the ring derives its power from a magical lantern. So, okay, anything else?
Are you shitting me?
I think what you're asking is, how does an Earthling get involved in all this? Well, it just so happens that our sector of the galaxy needs a new guardian. So they settle on Air Force test pilot Hal Jordan because of his heart. So there's that. Anything else?
Right.
Huh? Oh, good. We get that a lot, actually. And you know, I'm here to assure you that Green Lantern is a high adventure throwback, really. Kind of a fish out of water, you know, a lot of fun that way. And I really feel it provides the complete entertainment experience. So, you know, and I wouldn't be here if it wasn't. So, one last question.
I'm still having a hard time following this.
Oh, well, it's basically a love story.
What? Wait a minute. Hold on a second.
Guys, thank you for your time.
Hey, ho.
Okay. That's fun. That's one we quoted for years after. The fuck?
The fuck?
But just the idea of press conference, people going, yeah. Yeah, exactly. But the idea of a press conference, people going, huh? Is their question.
And this is the one I talked about yesterday that I love. When Super 8 came out, Steve had an idea for a sketch where Steven Spielberg and J.J. Abrams are coming together to make a movie. Will anyone say no to that? Is there nothing they could pitch that wouldn't be greenlit? How far could that concept go as to what they could possibly pitch where Warner Brothers would have to turn them down? Because otherwise, Warner Brothers say Spielberg, Abrams, done deal.
What do you guys want? Yeah.
Well, let's see how it goes.
Let's see.
Think about the last time you really, really, really wanted to see a movie you knew nothing about. It's a Hollywood trick that's great, but they fail that far too often. Nervously putting everything in the trailer, except, of course, for the fact that Bruce Willis was dead all along.
Thanks a lot, asshole! You just ruined Die Hard 4 for me.
Yes, only in a collaboration between two of the biggest filmmakers working today could they possibly push the marketing department into adopting Fuck If We Know as the tagline to a movie named after a shitty hotel chain. I mean, what must it be like to try and say no to these guys? Brave men have tried.
Mr. Abrams, Mr. Spielberg, thanks for coming in today. Word on the street is you two guys are cooking up some great little ideas, and you know, us folks over here at Paramount always love to have another blockbuster on hand. Now, can't make any promises in the room. I'm not a yes machine, but love to hear what you have to say. What do you got?
A nun who can fly.
Hasn't that been done before?
Not with J.J. Abrams and Steven Spielberg's names in the credits. It hasn't.
Good point. You got me there. Love it. Go.
A deer falls in love with a hunting rifle.
I don't think I see the angle there.
Steven Spielberg does. And it's a crazy upturned angle with a bold hero shot set against a gleaming sunset. It'll make E.T. flying across the moon look like a turd.
Love it. What else you got?
A man whose ass falls in love with the ghost of Joe McCarthy.
Just his ass? Seems highly unlikely.
Less unlikely than a downed plane load of people on a deserted island being transformed into a story lasting 6 mega successful seasons? That unlikely?
You got me there, JJ. Love it. Let's go.
Planet of the Apes remake for bovines.
Planet of the cows. Sorry, I don't see it working. I'm going to have to say no.
There's a 3D theme park ride.
Really? All right, write up a treatment. I got to see this one.
Really?
Really? Yeah, what else you got? Anything else?
Okay. Germany wins.
Germany wins.
Yes. Germany wins. It's an alternate history where Germany wins World War II.
I'm afraid to ask, but okay, then what?
Well, of course, the final solution gets put into place. Then,
right.
Cut to 50 years later, some crazy entrepreneur gets it in his head that he's going to build a theme park. Well, he gets the DNA of all the Jews, blacks, and gypsies that were encased in amber all those years, and he replicates all those now extinct species so that visitors can view them in their natural habitat.
Oh my gosh.
Wait a minute, it gets better. Because of a power failure in the park, the newly cloned species break free from their captors and wreak all sorts of havoc.
This is awful, that's terrible.
Life finds a way. That'll be the moral.
No, absolutely not. Over my dead body, no.
We've got Tom Hanks attached.
Really?
And Will Smith.
Well, get marketing on the phone for me. In legal. In the Museum of Tolerance.
Movie guys!
I forgot that was the punchline. And the Museum of Tolerance.
That yeah. One's a little but funny.
A little edgy. A little edgy, but that was, you know. Cope with an edgy idea, you're like, all right, well, how would you actually deliver that premise?
Animated, you know? And then they'd get away with everything.
Right.
So those were the live show days.
That's cool. Gosh, thank you for the waltz down memory lane there. I'd forgotten how tight those shows were, too, you know? Yeah. Hey, I'm wearing my Mitchell shirt. My sister gave me that shirt. Mitchell.
Yeah, movie t-shirts and attire required for that one. Sure.
Yeah.
And then we got into the Toad Hop days I mentioned before with
Toad Hop, which is where we met Christian and yeah. Mark.
Yep. Yeah. And
they were unfortunately the show after us, waiting for us to pick up props a lot of the times. Like
then we got then we started podcasting on our own outside of that network where those guys were, and then we did all sorts of stuff. Let's see, I got picture of one of our Christmas shows here. Steve's in the mix of that with Mike Nichols, David Beach.
See, the garage has changed from the earlier photo.
Yes, we added a studio and it's a whole podcast. That's kind of how it looks today, except there's like a piano and some other stuff in there as well.
Yeah,
at my house.
The boobies.
But, yeah, so that yielded some crazy stuff. And then we should mention that we shot entire, where did that photo go? Go away, photo. Nope, stop. We did a whole holiday special as well. Now, this was a full holiday special, shot beginning to end. Karen and I hosted it, and there were segments you would find in a holiday special. If you can go find these online, they're really some of the proudest stuff I think we've ever done. They're pretty amazing.
So good. So yeah. Good. Like, because we were like, we want to do a real full holiday special. We want songs. We want special appearances. We want, and yet all tied around that week's releases?
Yeah, well, for all the holidays at least, so probably a few weeks. They dump everything in the holidays, so we'd cover like 6 or 7 movies. So yeah. A number of years back, Sherlock Holmes 2, I think, came out. I think. And Steve turned it into Story Time with Steve, where he would tell us the Christmas tale of Sherlock Holmes. And it went like this. And it went a little something like this.
Like this.
Santa Claus is coming to town. He's bringing presents, etc. Thanks, Leah. Somebody else at the door.
Hey, Steve! Steve here was just about to read us a Christmas story.
I was?
Yes, I was. Yes, indeed I was.
In fact, he's going to read the Christmas classic, Sherlock Holmes, Game of Shadows.
That's not a Christmas classic.
Well, neither is Christmas with the Cranks. Didn't stop my grandparents from buying it in Blu-ray.
This is a press kit.
All right, so now that fabled Christmas classic, Sherlock Holmes, Game of Shadows.
Oh.
Okay, everyone, gather around. There once was a man named Sherlock Holmes.
and he knew kung fu, dodged cannonballs, dressed in drag, and fought men on trains.
That doesn't sound like Sherlock Holmes.
Oh, this isn't your father, Sherlock Holmes.
Doesn't sound like Arthur Conan Doyle's either.
What happened to all the pondering with a pipe?
Sherlock Holmes 1 happened to that. Where have you been? But hey, don't worry about it. Moriarty's in this one. And as we all know, Moriarty is the Lex Luthor of the Sherlock Holmes world. So, there's that. Yeah.
But what does it have to do with Christmas?
Watson looks jolly. Or maybe just gay. Definitely British. In other words, Jude Law. So, let's see, what else here? Christmas. Okay, here we go. It says right here, Holmes and Watson try to stop a plot that could destroy the world. And as we all know, the world is where Santa lives. So, you could say that they're really trying to save Christmas.
But that doesn't make it a Christmas story.
It's a metaphor.
A metaphor for what?
Do metaphors always need an analogy?
Yeah, but only by definition.
But do we always have to go by the definition?
Yes, but only when the subject is words.
But is Sherlock Holmes really about the words?
You mean the book?
But what about caroling and presents and goodwill towards men?
Okay, look. I'm not really much of a storyteller, okay? I'm more of a marketing guy, so why don't we just beat this out ourselves, okay? Let's decide what would make this a more seasonally appropriate tale, okay? Let's start with the title. Now, Sherlock Holmes' Game of Shadows sounds a bit October-ish, don't you think? How can we bring this up to the Christmas season? Why don't we call it Sherlock Holmes and the Case of the Impossible Chimney Width? Huh? Come on. Work with me here.
Sherlock Holmes and the Eggnog Expiration Adventure.
Okay. I like it.
Sherlock Holmes and the Bathhouse Mistletoe Mix-Up.
Oh, nice. That brings in a few demographics. They're good. Yeah.
Sherlock Holmes and the Terrible Trip to Target.
Oh, nothing says the holidays like a trip to Target. Okay, come on. Let's brainstorm this now.
So how'd it go? I wasn't listening.
Oh, really good, actually. We didn't come up with a different title yet, or even a significantly different story. But we did arrive at a promotional tagline that is much more seasonally appropriate.
I would love to hear it.
This Christmas, go Holmes for the holidays. Okay, we got nothing.
And that became the tradition. I had Steve doing the Christmas story, but it was always the plot of some movie that was coming up that had nothing to do with Christmas.
Yeah.
It always had that moment where he's like, okay, you know what? Let's they just put it away. Like, all right, let's work on this. I think we can make this more Christmassy. That's very
good. Yeah,
classic.
We did a whole show once where we previewed every movie during the holidays and then said, and then we had like the, this just in, the new Christmas and the way that Christmasized the movie. Christmas ending, attacking on a holiday ending to the film.
Oh yeah, attacking on the holiday ending. That's right. And then your friend Corrado dressed as Santa Claus and reviewed. Who was the one he reviewed as Santa? Because it was a Christmas release.
He reviewed The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo and Shame as Santa.
Dressed as Santa, going ho ho ho, and the story. And he told the whole plot in that Santa voice. That was just so funny.
Did I play that during last Christmas? Do you think I would have?
Not sure, but you know, now that we have a Monday show, we might have to put together a Christmas show this year.
Yeah, we should.
Bring on some pre-recorded, see if we can get Corrado doing that bit again. Something absolutely inappropriate will be coming out at Christmas, because that's what we did every time. We did the three of those Christmas specials in a row, and that was always the bit.
So then Steve, every once in a while, would just take a whole movie on by himself.
Yeah,
I think he wanted to see the one where he talked about Red.
Right? Yes.
All right, so the movie Red, we all remember Bruce Willis and old people. What is it? Retired and Extremely Dangerous?
Retired and Extremely Dangerous, yeah.
Here's Steve's take on his, what they call the spoiler-free preview.
Spoiler-free preview.
Red opens this week, starring Morgan Freeman in the title role. This is, of course, the long-awaited sequel to the 1994 classic The Shawshank Redemption, wherein Freeman so memorably portrayed the character of Ellis Boyd Redding, known to his fellow inmates simply as Red. Of course, as everyone recalls, at the end of that movie, Red is on his way to Mexico to meet up with his old prison buddy, Andy Dufresne. When he gets to Mexico, he finds that things are not as they seem. Andy has apparently run afoul of the local authorities and has spent several years languishing in a Mexican prison. Proving that he's still the man who knows how to find things, Red springs into action, finding and recruiting a team of ragtag ex-convicts and prison guards played by Bruce Willis, John Malkovich, and Helen Mirren, who band together to bust Andy out of the joint. If that weren't enough, Red is also being pursued by his vengeful parole officer, played by a gruff-voiced Carl Urban. All of this adds up to some white-knuckle tension and high-octane excitement, which were really the only two elements missing from the 1994 original, making this film more than a mere Shawshank repetition, if you catch my meaning. Anyway, that's what the movie looks like to me. So if you've seen it, no spoilers, please, as I intend to go into this baby totally fresh, which is why I purposely found out nothing about it up until now. For the movie, guys, I'm Stephen Lewis.
Movie guy! Took us out of there.
Oh, well, hello.
Hello.
So yeah, now I forgot the whole concept of that, the spoiler-free preview, because of course he misunderstands what the entire movie is.
Yeah, he does it. And I always loved, because he always loved Bill Murray's appearances on the Saturday Night Live news desk back in the day, and that sort of like, you know, more confidence than knowledge, you know, like presenting the whole blustery version. But I just loved his catchphrase there, at least. That's what it looks like to me.
I'll play one more. I got the beaver. Big Mama's like father, like son, or the tourist? The tourist seems, you know, modern because of the whole
Red was my favorite. The others I don't remember. So yeah, throw something in there.
Let's watch the tourist.
Only a couple minutes apiece.
Well, the Hollywood remake machine goes into high gear again this week with the release of The Tourist. The film stars Johnny Depp and Angelina Jolie in the roles made famous a generation ago by William Hurt and Gina Davis in The Accidental Tourist. Looks like this time around, the title is the only thing that has gotten simpler, as a poignant heartwarmer has been transformed into a plot-twisting thrill ride. The 1988 classic had Hurt's character, withdrawn and depressed after the death of his son, thrown for an emotional loop upon hooking up with the kooky and outgoing Gina Davis, whom he initially hires to discipline his dog. Well, substitute a crazy international espionage plot for an unruly dog, and you've basically got this new movie in a nutshell. Like Hurt, Depp will have his staid and quiet life shaken up, this time by Jolie's foxy secret agent, and the two will come to form a lasting and life-affirming emotional bond. Now, the good news here is that Johnny and Angie seem to share the same quirky on-screen chemistry as Bill and Gina did all those years ago. However, it will be very interesting to see how the harrowing issues of death, grief, and abandonment are handled this time around within the confines of an action movie plot. It may be another case of Hollywood dumbing down the emotional content of a story in its endless pursuit of thrills, and if that happens, we may have the same travesty on our hands as we had a few years back when the Robert De Niro classic Taxi Driver was remade as Taxi, starring Jimmy Fallon. In that case, the original story was all but unrecognizable, and the same thing may happen with The Tourist, in which case, don't say I didn't warn. For the movie, guys, this is Stephen Lewis.
Great editing, Paul. You had the tourist logo and everything there with the...
Yeah.
No, you really did those up.
He just didn't get it.
No, he just didn't get it. But it's that just a great tone he plays of the full confidence having not gotten it, you know? I can't believe they would do this. Yeah.
Let me play one more second of a thing, and then I see you get to all the new stuff. Make sure everybody gets a big helping of Steve.
Yeah.
This is, I won't play all of this, but this is us going to and from Avatar. Back in 2009, yeah. Steve, Bart, and I were going to go see Avatar. The only tickets available were like Saturday morning, I believe, so this is how it went.
That's right.
That you can find a whole bunch of to and froms. We've done them here, where we take a camera to and from them. Although I don't know how much longer they are for this world, because all we do is rail about how quickly critics come up with an opinion about a movie. And then we do a to and from where we have a quick opinion about
immediate opinion, yeah.
Yes, but anyway.
All right. To and from Avatar.
Very early. We're going to see Avatar. 9:45 a.m.
And when we say we mean myself, Mr. Preston. Hey, look, it's Matt Steve. It's Matt Steve. Yeah. I love cartoons, so I'm very excited about it.
But you are required, aren't you, by all the laws of Hollywood marketing to care about Avatar?
Absolutely, yeah. It's a city ordinance. The levy passed, and I'm apparently going to have to care.
They have worked hard to make you give a shit. So by God, it's un-American not to. Not Steve. Avatar waits for no man. IMAX 3D, the way Cameron intends it. I wonder how...
The way God intended it.
The way God intended it.
So this is will actually be my first 3D experience since 3D has been apparently perfected. I have not seen any of the 3D movies.
9:45 a.m. Yeah. Saturday morning. Avatar. Sold out.
Do you know they have this bogus language that they speak in this movie? And there's some nerd out of some nerd university that created this?
I only know that because he was on the cover of Parade magazine on the newsstand or whatever.
No kidding.
Well, I heard him interviewed on Nerd Public Radio. And this guy is such a nerd. Turning left here? No.
Does he talk like this?
Yeah, I mean,
he created the Navi.
Well, he's the only guy that can speak this language. And I'm thinking, what a scam is that? Because there's no way we can verify whether or not his translation is accurate. So the host would say, oh, how do I say, good morning, it's nice to see you. And he would come up with some gibberish, and they go, oh, that's wonderful. Well, of course it's wonderful. There's no way for me to verify whether or not. Anyway,
yes,
you've been had, James Cameron.
I think that even surpasses in nerddom the guy who translated Shakespeare into Klingon.
Will the subtitles be in 3D?
So the words will be coming out at you.
I want to see him describe the subtitles in the pitch meeting.
No, you don't understand. The subtitles will come out at you in a 3D, and they'll cost $150 million alone just for the subtitles to come
People
at you.
People will be scared of an R for the first time.
Jurassic Park game.
I just got that. I love coming to this place because some people, I come here just casually, just to hang out, watch a movie, or grab a bite to eat. Some people have planned their entire vacation around this day, right? They're going to spend the entire day at Universal City.
Right.
It's in my backyard.
They're not local.
They're not local.
How long until we get Ray parking?
Last time?
Grace Park game. She played a Cylon. All right, I got to explain Garage Rage. A little something I like to call Garage.
Garage? Yeah.
These guys just...
Can we park anywhere now?
People don't know that you just need to keep driving until there are no more cars, and then park your car.
Did you see how much he missed that spot by? He wasn't even close.
Oh, I thought the guy was pulling out. He was pulling in.
He just
because there's so much around him.
He missed it by that.
Yeah,
much.
He.
Where is the elevator?
I don't know. See, they're like, what are these idiots doing? Just park your car, get out, and go to the movies.
I don't know. Looking forward to it. 3D experience should be.
Very much looking forward to seeing Kate Winslet and Leonardo DiCaprio.
But like any good James Cameron movie, I imagine that Titanic will make an appearance at some point.
In cartoon form.
Avatar Postmortem.
Dances with Wolves meets Star Wars. Go.
The Phantom Menace.
But there's a tremendous amount of symbolism in there. I mean, I don't know if you saw all, but for me, we get it. Unobtainium? They called it unobtainium.
That was shocking.
Ridiculous.
That was ridiculous. Wouldn't call it that.
How's the wonder?
Unobtainium?
How's the wonder flonium going? Unobtainium? That's not why I go to the movies. I don't go to the movies to be preached at. For 3 hours, I was preached at.
Yeah, it will be the biggest grossing Iraq war movie.
well, yes. It's not competing
since
with
Jarhead. Right. You know, I wouldn't rush out to see it at 9:45 in the a.m. on a Saturday.
Yeah, you'd have to be an idiot.
How would you gauge this as a 3D experience compared to other movies you saw? Because it's my first one, really, and I was amazed how immersed I was in the
I thought the 3D was a little distracting.
Did you?
Because it didn't stay, the image didn't stay consistent. You got blurriness, you got some digitization, depending on how your glasses were fitting or how you moved your head. For instance, if you sat there with your head perfectly square, you were fine, but if you kind of tilted your head and your glasses tilted, you got sort of a blurry effect.
Wait, was this your first 3D like me? Like your first 3D?
No, I get out of the house, dude.
Oh my gosh.
It goes on for another 2 minutes, but I stopped it.
Yeah.
But the funny part is it ends and then it comes back again and Steve's like, I have a huge headache.
Yeah. It like, gave him a huge headache. Yeah. And it was really delayed. I remember him telling me about that too. He's like, I got home and I was just like, I got to lay down. And the whole room started spinning. This is like hours later. And he's like, I don't think I ever saw a 3D movie again. Yeah. I have a huge headache.
Yeah.
But boy, that really captures the feeling of like hanging out and driving to a movie with you guys back in the day, man. That's that's kind of a fun thrill. Like I feel like I'm going to the movies with vintage us.
Yeah.
Well, very cool.
Yeah, including Steve being late.
And I was hoping there'd be a shot in there because he would have been driving my car, I believe, at the time. Bridget, the old.
Probably. Well, there's a great sample of a bunch of Steve's funny stuff that I have, and I think we can move on to Adam.
Thank you for bringing, God, the 3-minute variety hour. I forgot about so much stuff, and just look
it's
how...
It's nowhere. Where is it? It's, like, here in a little basket.
Yeah.
On a disc. Like, so, I mean, you can't see it anywhere else. Might as well show it here.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I am. I have the last three things that we worked on together. And they never made it to the show because I'm a terrible friend and I don't get stuff edited very quickly. But
but I should also say, Steve is on 2 episodes of the Ford Fiesta. So jump on over there and listen. I think you mentioned it yesterday. He was on Love, for sure.
Love and Forced Him from Navarone.
Forced Him. Okay, so check those out when you get the chance.
Forced Him from Navarone, that is a movie he loved his entire lifetime. I've talked about Forced Him from Navarone with him for a while. He gave me a copy of it for Christmas once. It was a great, and it probably tells the story, because I know his brothers are going to be watching this, but he tells a great story about going to see it with his brothers and talk about going to see like a war movie with your brothers and yeah, all this stuff. It's that's a really fun one. Oh yes, yeah. It's
Bud
it's
Alabaster.
Bud Alabaster. I will show. So I have The Untouchables. I'll show that first. And The Untouchables was a sketch that we recorded a long time ago, or he recorded a long time ago. It might not have been with me. It might have been with Matt Larson. And he always wanted to put it on the show. And the old thing was recorded on cassette, so we pulled out some real microphones. And about a year ago, we re-recorded the Untouchables sketch. Now, it's an audio sketch. It was meant to be put on one of our audio formats. But I have added Untouchables footage to it. It is a longer sketch, about a 2-minute scene in the movie, so you're just going to see the same clips lipped over and over, and it's not really...
Oh, I do know this. This is good.
Not really matching the lips or anything. I just wanted a visual example. So you'll see the same thing over and over from a famously short scene in this 5-minute sketch. But it is the Untouchables sketch. Steve loved this sketch, wrote this, I believe, all himself. Might have improvised it originally with Matt Larson. Actually, the original sketch might have been him and Matt Larson, but this is me and him as the voice of Malone and Elliot Ness. So here we go. I want to get Capone. Now, how do I get him?
You want to get him? Here's how you get him. He pulls a knife, you pull a gun. He puts one of yours in the hospital, you put one of his in the morgue. That's the Chicago way. And that's how you get Capone. You understand? I get your general meaning, but I need a specific plan of action, Malone. Oh, you want specifics? I'll give them to you. Listen up. He stubs his toe, you pull your hamstring. He pulls his hamstring, you break both your legs. That's the Chicago way. No, wait a minute. You lost me there. Don't you see, Mr. Ness? You got to be willing to build up incrementally and beat these people at their own game. He drives a car, you take the bus. He drives a bus, you fly a plane. He buys a plane, you get a yacht.
Well, hold on. How am I supposed to
Again, he strikes a match, you use a lighter. He uses a lighter, you get a Bunsen burner. He gets a Bunsen burner, you light up a flamethrower. That's the Chicago way.
I don't see how the Chicago way is going to help me catch Capone.
It's a... Catch him. You want to catch him?
Yes, that's what this is all about.
Why?
Why? Because he's a menace. He's terrorizing the city. He, for God's sakes, what did you think I wanted you to do?
I thought you wanted to humiliate him.
What?
You know, one-up him, make him look bad, embarrass him in front of his boys.
Why would I want to do that?
I don't know, but you said help me get Capone, so I was trying to help you get Capone. That's a Chicago way. That's how you get someone here. But now you're telling me you want to catch him?
Yes.
Well, that's dangerous.
I know, that's why I came to you.
I mean, you could get yourself killed.
Yes, I know that. That's why I came to you. I was told you had gotten Capone once before.
Oh, yeah, I got him good.
Great. What did you do?
I gave him a wedgie once. Yeah. But that was a long time ago, Mr. Ness. I was a younger man.
Oh, my God, a wedgie? That's it?
Now, hold on a second there. Never underestimate the power of a good, solid wedgie.
I'm not interested in giving Capone a wedgie.
How about just pantsing him, then?
No!
Okay, here's something. Low risk, but very effective. You drive by in a car real fast and moon him. Hit him right where he lives. The man's got family now.
Listen to me. I've sworn to put Capone behind bars for good. I thought I could count on you for your help, but if I can't, then I'll just find a way to do it without you. Goodbye, Malone.
Okay, hold on there, Mr. Ness. I didn't say I wouldn't help you. You just... All right. You want to catch him? Here's how you catch him. He pulls a knife, you kick a poodle. He puts one of yours in the hospital, you systematically kill 14 bellboys with an ice pick.
What?
He's caught speeding, you castrate 8 high school students. He gets a gun shipment, you run 17 postal employees through meat grinders.
Now, hold on a second.
He jaywalks, you shoot out all the windows of a high rise. He reupholsters his living room, you butcher an entire family and spray helter-skelter on the walls.
No, stop. This is absolutely disgusting.
So I see Mr. Tough Guy can't take the heat. No one said it would be easy, Mr. Ness. Not a mission for the faint of heart.
I'm not faint of heart. I just don't see how brutalizing innocent people is going to help us catch Capone.
Don't you see, Mr. Ness? We have to create an atmosphere of fear and paranoia in this city. Cloak it with a palpable threat of violence so that no one feels safe, even in their own homes.
But Capone already does that.
That's right. So you've got to do him one better. You start matching him in brutality, and you can bet he'll feel the heat. He'll open up the paper and say, "Oh my God, I didn't order these 12 golf pros to be sodomized by wombats. Or who had these 7 construction workers neutered with a pickaxe?" And he'll wonder what the hell this city is coming to.
And then what?
He'll turn himself in.
That is, without a doubt, the stupidest, most twisted, far-flung plan I've ever heard in my life.
Oh, well, you have a better idea?
Well, it seems to me that it would make the most sense to go after his base of operations, his warehouses, his hideouts, his bootlegging facilities.
Oh, sure. The obvious approach. Brilliant.
What are you talking about?
I might as well just say he pulls a knife, you kill him. He puts one of yours in the hospital, you kill him. He sits, he stands, he does anything, you kill him.
That's brilliant.
It is?
I've never thought of it that way before. It's so simple. He does something just... Wait, what was it again?
Kill him.
Kill him. It cuts out the middleman.
Now, Mr. Ness, no, wait a minute. Don't go off half-cocked here.
I can't believe nobody's ever thought of this before. Malone, you're a genius. I owe you one.
Mr. Ness, where are you going?
I'm going to kill Capone.
But
what?
That's not the Chicago way.
Ugh.
Wait a minute. I've got it. Get him on his income taxes.
So that was a classic, redone very recently.
Modern classic, yes.
Yes. And the last two sketches here I have. One was Steve just recorded on his phone. I gussied it up with some clips because he intended it to be kind of a segment for the movie guys. And he's kind of coming up with some philosophical points about Sam Raimi, who I've mentioned. If you would like to honor Steve, watch a Sam Raimi movie tonight. So this is, and he couched this in sort of a format that he came up with called the Proofs of God. So something had indicated to him through his love of Sam Raimi and Lunchables, the Proof of God. So here is Steve with a good analysis of some Sam Raimi stuff, couched in a format that he wanted to put on the Movie Guys and is only now just finished. But here we go.
Hello, Stephen Lewis here, and this is another episode in my ongoing Proofs of God. Proofs that I see in the world around me of being an intelligence force higher than ours, a force which binds us,
surrounds us, penetrates us.
As a film guy, I like it when the universe can provide metaphors that I can use in film reviews. And here's one of them. I'm having a Lunchable. Here I have a cracker on which I'm putting ham and a little cheese. Cracker, ham, and cheese. It's a perfect metaphor for the perfect Sam Raimi movie. You got your cheesy layer.
Raindrops keep falling on my head.
You know, and your fun campiness. And usually got a ham or two of an actor.
Well, hello, Mr. Fancy Pants.
Chewing up the scenery.
Could you pay me in advance?
Serious?
But you got a cracker. You got something real and substantive underneath it all. You know, I'm talking Dark Man. I'm talking Spider-Man 2. I'm talking The Quick and the Fucking Dead, man. I'm talking, dead. Man. I'm talking, well, actually, A Simple Plan. That's just all cracker.
I'll do it, Hank, if you don't.
No!
Tell us you I will.
The Evil Dead franchise. It has no cracker. Just has the ham and the cheese. And that's enjoyable, to be sure. But for me, the complete Raimi experience is when you get the cracker, the substantive story, the morality tale that he is telling at the center of it all. And it's usually something pretty fucking stark, like Dark Man tells us a good man who goes bad and is content to do so because of the monster that he has become.
I know you did. But let's pretend you didn't.
And it's like saying some things in life are so bad that happen to you, they change you in ways you can't be changed back.
God, what have I become? What have I become?
And that's what Dark Man is. It's a dark vision at the center of that movie that he makes so palatable and fun and makes it so you want to watch it. And so you get that message hammered into you all the time because you're so delighted by the things in the movie that you want to watch the movie and then you're reminded at the cracker at the center of that movie. Quick and the Dead, too. It's the, you know, the fun of it is it's a Sergio Leone ripoff kind of thing where a woman is as the man with no name. She's the Clint Eastwood character, you know. And it's a town where there's just nothing but gunfights. They have a gunfight competition. I mean, on paper, it sounds like the stupidest idea. And so that's the cheese. And you got Gene Hackman, who's the great ham, one of the greatest villains of all time.
You've all managed to find the money to hire a professional gunfighter to kill me.
You know, so it's just, you know, it's a lot of fun. But the cracker underneath it all is this is a woman who isn't just a badass to be a badass. She specifically come back to this town because this is the town where her father was sheriff. And Herod, Gene Hackman's character, killed him. Actually, worse than killed him. Strung him up and told his, like, 9-10-year-old daughter that she could have her daddy go free if she could shoot down the rope. The cracker of it is, the message to the kids is that evil does exist, and evil loves itself. And sometimes there is no one to stand up for it but you. You're the last one, because she ain't no gunfighter. She learned how to use a gun, but she never became what he became, a stone-cold killer. And she wonders, can me with a conscience going up against a stone-cold killer prevail? I mean, that's some deep shit that he's mixing with that ham and cheese. Evil Dead doesn't have any of that.
I got news for you, pal. You ain't leading but two things right now. Jack and shit. Jack left town.
I guess he means it just to be fun, and it is, but without the substance, it's not the true Raimi Lunchable that I've come to expect. From the fact that I could make such a cheesy metaphor and you would understand it is, curiously, today, my proof of God.
Wow.
Right? So, a funny Steve metaphor through Lunchables regarding Sam Raimi. You know, that,
I'm looking at my Quick of the Dead Blu-ray over there, which Steve gave me once.
Ah, yes, that's right. He thought everybody should have a copy. Yes.
I love the thanks, Sean. What up, movie guys? You're my favorite Twitch streamers. And he chimed in. He chimed in on YouTube. To say
on YouTube,
because no one watches this on Twitch.
No, we don't even know why we
we're the tree in the forest over there.
By the way, I do see one last clip down here. I just want to share a Steve story. Funny Steve story, and if his relatives are watching this, obviously they are Cincinnati Reds fans from birth, even though they've split to the winds away from Cincinnati, all of them. But I was in Vegas once, and this was actually when we went for one of our football days. And of course, you can run into Pete Rose anytime if you have the money. And he just sits down and signs baseballs in a and signs various paraphernalia for money in a in one of the casinos, Bellagio, I believe. And so this was a very funny story. Here's... Actually, let me set this up a little further. The funny thing was, we get in there, and Steve is a Reds fan from birth, and he immediately... So the whole time we're getting up there, he goes, oh, I really want to tell him, like, my experience with the Big Red Machine as a little kid. And it was basically, like, them winning the World Series. I think it was, like, one of his first memories of watching baseball or whatever. So... He's like, oh, I want to tell him this story or whatever, and something like that. And I'm like, eh, he's kind of just here to sign autographs. So Steve, as he walks up with the baseball that you have to buy to sign and the money or whatever, tries to have this conversation about the Big Red Machine with Pete. Pete ain't having it. But as you watch here, as soon as Steve notes that Pete has an iPad with the football games that we've got money on, he immediately starts talking about the money he has on that game, and Pete lights up. So he notes. So now Pete's talking because we're talking about gambling and sports, which I just found so funny. So now they're talking because it's about gambling and sports, which of course, if you're going to talk to Pete Rose. Now they're having an actual conversation.
Oh,
and now we're talking.
That's right, I tuned out for a second.
I just found that so funny that he got to talk to Pete, but not about the Big Red Machine. As soon as he started talking about games that Steve had money on and Pete had money on, now they're talking. Now we're friends. Oh, really? So what are you talking? Like, he just lit up. It's so funny. But let's close out the show here with the very most recent thing that Steve had an idea for, and a genius idea. This will get us a copyright strike because I use this music throughout it, but this was such a clever idea, and one day, you know, we were like, oh, we should write that or whatever, and we just decided, and this was after a Pink Panther movie marathon. This is one of the last movie marathons we had, was every Pink Panther movie, and before he was leaving, he's like, you know what, let's just pop in the movie that you're going to see the premise here and bring up that music, and then we'll just figure it out. And Steve just sat there on paper. I probably still have the paper, actually, of just like, oh, and then we go to this scene, then we go to this scene. And this was as much of an improv as it was writing. Because the premise, it's one of those premises you go, oh, it writes itself, but then you got to sit down and do the work. So just almost improvisationally, we put this together with clips from the movie and a piece of music. So here it is, The Godfather in development. Thank you.
This is the story of a mob family whose patriarch was shot, and the one son who had no choice but to hold everything together. He is the Godfather in development.
Narrated by Steve, of course.
Michael was preparing for his meeting with Mo Green later that day in Las Vegas. The Corleones were planning on buying out Mo's share in the Tropicana and taking over controlling ownership of the hotel and casino themselves. But Michael's brother Fredo, who worked with Mo, was not so sure it was a good idea.
Mike, are you sure about that? Mo loves the business. He never said nothing to me about it, son.
Yeah, I'll make him an offer he can't refuse.
I'll make him an offer he can't refuse is a phrase much used by the Corleones in their business dealings.
My father made him an offer he couldn't refuse.
When Vito wanted to get his godson Johnny Fontaine out of a bad recording contract, he said this.
I'm going to make him an offer he can't refuse.
And that offer was this.
Luca Brasi held a gun to his head, and my father assured him that either his brains or his signature would be on the contract.
So Michael decided to call in a favor with Johnny Fontaine and asked him to be present at his meeting that day with Mo Green.
See, we figure that entertainment will be a big factor in drawing gamblers at the casino, and we hope you'll sign a contract to appear 5 times a year. Perhaps convince some of your friends in the movies to do the same.
A pregnant pause filled the room. No one wanted to say anything. It was awkward. Finally, Johnny spoke up.
Sure, Mike. I'll do anything for my godfather. You know that.
Just then, Mo Green arrived for the meeting.
Do you know who I am? I'm Mo Green. I made my bones when you were going out with cheerleaders.
Michael had never actually gone out with a cheerleader before. But he never liked to contradict Mo in these things, so he quickly got down to business instead.
Corleone family wants to buy you out.
No, I buy you out, you don't buy me out.
The casino loses money.
Mo had been under the impression that his casino operation was bigger and more averse to failure than it was.
We're bigger than U.S. Steel.
They weren't. And like Michael said, they were losing money. But it wasn't for the reason that Mo feared.
You think I'm skimming off the top, Mike?
Actually, it was because since Fredo began working there, he'd been preventing a lot of orders from being taken at the bar.
He was banging cocktail waitresses 2 at a time. Players couldn't get a drink at the table.
Michael, meanwhile, had developed a foolproof way to cut down on this problem.
I want to see you at the hotels. I don't want you near my house.
On the next Godfather in Development, Michael's sister Connie orders a hit on a rival family, which Michael did not approve.
Just when I thought I was out, they pulled me back in.
And there it is.
Yeah, bravo, bravo.
Bravo, Stephen Lewis. Yeah. Oh my gosh, yes. So that was the last piece we ever worked on, and God, that's a good one.
Way to go out, Steve.
Right? You will be missed.
Thanks for everything. Yes, you will be missed. I don't know who I'm going to see Brian Wilson in Chicago with this Thursday.
Man,
so you're the kind of guy I would have called to go see that concert.
100%.
And you'll be missed.
Yeah. Well, thanks everyone for watching this, and this will be archived too, so any family members haven't had a chance to see it will be able to tune in and check it out. Thanks everyone for watching and enjoying it, and I know a lot of these are our newer friends that we have through the Movie Trivia Schmodown, and this has been very cool to show you some of the comic talents of our friend Stephen Lewis, and the old movie guys, the old lineup, the classic lineup.
And you know what? A special Kieran Lagabiru for Steve. Yeah. Yeah. Let's do it. Here we go.
Konbanwa.
Are?
Si. Kashita no. Kieran Lagabiru kudasai. Kirippon. No. Kieran Lagabiru kudasai.
Hai. Kieran Lagabiru.
Mr. Beer.
Kirin Lagerbier.
Everybody drinks Kirin Lagerbier.
There you go. That was
and a sure. Kirin Lagerbier to you.
Yes. Oh, I thought you had a maybe a Kirin for a second there.
No. You know what? I really should start buying it, shouldn't I? It'd be a way to toast off each show.
Got to walk the walk. And as ever, thanks to Steve Schultz for helping us out with some writing. And check us out at The Movie Guys everywhere. There is social and, of course, themovieguys.net.
Oh, and you know what I forgot?
I have to make an announcement, though. Yeah. This Saturday, if you're in the L.A. area at all, Ghostbusters Afterlife. It's happening at the UMI Credit Union in Burbank. That's 3000 Magnolia. It's between Hollywood and Buena Vista. You won't miss it because I'm going to be there with my giant inflatables and my Ecto-1 hosting this screening in full Ghostbusters outfit. So if you want to see Ghostbusters Afterlife and enjoy an outdoor movie, it's the summer. We should be doing that. UMI Credit Union, 3000 Magnolia in Burbank this Saturday. About 6 o'clock, I think the food trucks are going to set up. There's going to be some other vendors. I'll get there and probably fire up some games around 7 o'clock, have some giveaways, do trivia, that kind of stuff. And as soon as it's dark enough, we start up the movie, Ghostbusters Afterlife, which is, you know, which is getting a sequel, I heard. It made enough. Because Jason Reitman didn't overspend like Paul Feig, which is... Right. I enjoyed Ghostbusters 2016, but that's his biggest flaw, is that they spent too much, and then it got... You know, got knocked for losing money, and it did. So this one, get ready for the new one, whenever it comes out, by watching Ghostbusters Afterlife Saturday.
Cool. That's awesome. Yeah, that's great. That
plug before we get too far along.
Yeah.
Anything else, Adam?
One last thing. I've forgotten to upload it, but I just uploaded it right now. It's processing. But one of the enduring things that we've played on the show that is definitely property of Stephen Lewis, I worked on with him, was the movie trivia that we've previously begun shows with before, the crazy parody of the 90s movie trivia slideshow you would see before you would go into a movie. So instead of the movie nonsense, I think we're going to end with trivia. How about that today, Paul? Just end with a slew of trivia for the end of the show. Sure. Cool thing about this is just a funny idea that Steve and I had. We sat down, obviously I got the video console here, and we just started coming up with these jokes. You know, he started in crafting sort of how they played out and everything like that. Great fun story was, before Quentin Tarantino took over the New Beverly, I had become friendly with some of the people that worked there. Steve had become friendly with some people that worked there too. We went there a lot. And we asked one time, before the movie show, this could never happen now, but before you play the movie, could you play, you know, we gave him the CD and we go, could you play this trivia in a theatrical setting? And once we actually got this trivia played at the New Beverly, I framed that poster for him and circled the actual day that we had done that. But this is one of the things that Steve and I put together, that which people who've watched this show know, the movie trivia parody is definitely a property of Steve as well as myself. So
and we're back next week, and next week we talk Lightyear, right? I believe.
Lightyear.
If my June calendar is right, because there's nothing but summer blockbusters every week for the next few months. So,
yeah.
All right, fire up the trivia.
Here it goes. Thanks a lot, everyone. Kirin Lagerbier. We'll be right back.
And Mel Gibson as the Beaver. Who among us ever thought we'd hear that expression? But that's exactly what happens this week as Mad Max picks up where Jerry Mathers left off, portraying the lovable Theodore Beaver Cleaver from the classic sitcom Leave It to Beaver in a new movie opening this week about the Beaver's current day exploits. Apparently, someone on Mel's staff must have told him that playing a lovable American icon of innocence would probably be a good way to bolster his public image. But frankly, I'm not sure how comforting audiences are going to find this particular vision. From the looks of things, the Beave is going it alone this time. Ward and June are long gone, and older brother Wally has disappeared, replaced by a hand puppet with whom Beaver tries to recreate their warm fraternal relationship. It seems a pathetic gesture, and it plays out against the backdrop of the character's alcoholism, depression, and wrenching separation from his wife and kids. Clearly, this isn't your father's Beaver. And I have to openly wonder about the wisdom of treating such a whimsically conceived character with this degree of brutal realism. I mean, what's next? Opie's post-traumatic stress disorder? How about Marsha Brady, porn star junkie? Come on, guys, what's up with that? I mean, are we so addicted to snark that we have to throw these lovable characters under the bus just for our own amusement? Haven't we... Oh, wait a minute. I think I know what's going on here. I bet you anything, Eddie Haskell is the one behind this whole Let's Trash the Beaver master plot. He's such a scamp. Anyway, that's certainly what it looks like to me. For Movie Guys, I'm Stephen Lewis.
Movie Guys!